Hello and good morning, everyone, and welcome to our online worship today here on the second Sunday in Lent. And we think about Jesus preparing on that journey towards Jerusalem and all that was involved in. That's in our thoughts today. So come wherever you are and whoever you are. Come and worship God, because blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Let's begin with these words from Psalm 27. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Let's worship.
Creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice and let us sing. Alleluia, alleluia. Thou burning sun with golden beam, thou silver moon with softer gleam. Oh, praise him, oh, praise him.
Psalm 27 says, "One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord, and to seek him in his temple. For in the day of trouble he will keep me safe in his dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of his sacred tent, and set me high upon a rock." Let us pray. Living God, magnificent and mysterious, there is no place where you are not. But there are some places whose beauty or whose long history of being set apart for worship make it easier for us to be drawn into your presence. It pains us, Lord, as it did Jesus, to see such holy places being desecrated by conflict, exploitation, or abuse. and we weep with you for those who have died in violent attacks on mosques and churches, Hindu temples and Sikh gurdwaras. We grieve also for the attackers whose faith is so distorted that they imagine you might be pleased by their actions. It's easy, O God, to see where others have gone wrong, not so easy to admit to our own faults and failings. We too have dishonoured you and given our churches a bad name whenever we have listened to gossip or helped to spread it. When we have fallen out over something that seemed important at the time but actually matters not at all. Or when we have come here with anything other than worship at the forefront of our minds. And so forgive us, we pray, and help us, if it's not too late, to undo some of the damage we have caused. Draw us into the warmth of your embrace and hold us until our anger and confusion and fear begin to dwindle and we can go back out into the world again, ready to see other people, including those with whom we disagree, through your eyes of compassion and grace. May our journey with Jesus on the way to an end that we know so well be for us not a journey towards death, but a journey into life and hope and healing. Not for us alone, but for the world which is forever infused with your love because of Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.
In heavenly love abiding, no change my heart shall fear. And safe is such confiding, for nothing changes here. The storm may roar without me, my heart may low be laid. But God is round about me, and can I be dismayed? Wherever he may guide me, no one shall turn me back. My Saviour is beside me, and nothing can I lack. His wisdom ever waketh, his sight is never dim. He knows the way he taketh, and I will walk with him. Green pastures are before me, which yet I have not seen. Bright skies will soon reward me, where darkening clouds have been. My hope I cannot measure, my path to life is free. My Saviour has my treasure, and he will walk with me.
The first reading is from Paul's letter to the Philippians, chapter 3, beginning at verse 17. Hear the word of the Lord. Join with others in following my example, brothers, and take note of those who live according to the pattern we gave you. For, as I have often told you before, and now say again, even with tears, many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their destiny is destruction. Their God is their stomach, and their glory is in their shame. Their mind is on earthly things. But our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Saviour from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who, by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control, will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body. Therefore, my brothers, you whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, that is how you should stand firm in the Lord, dear friends. Gospel, chapter 13, beginning at verse 31. At that time some Pharisees came to Jesus and said to him, "Leave this place and go somewhere else. Herod wants to kill you." He replied, "Go tell that fox I will drive out demons and heal people today and tomorrow, and on the third day I will reach my goal. In any case, I must keep going today and tomorrow and the next day, for surely no prophet can die outside Jerusalem. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you, how often I have longed to gather your children together, as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing. Look, your house is left to you desolate. I tell you, you will not see me again until you say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.' Thanks be to God. Amen."
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Let us pray. O Lord, breathe your life-giving spirit into our hearts and minds. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Jesus spoke those words to the Pharisees who wanted him to protect himself from harm, not to go to Jerusalem and risk his life. But Jesus was not to be put off. The ancient words of the psalmist, those Passover words, greeted with palm branches and shouting, preceded by cries of Yahweh, Hosanna, save us, Yeshua, save us, Jesus. Jesus is Yeshua, the God who saves. Jesus' mission was to face Jerusalem and finish the work he came to do, to be the means of God's salvation, to make real God in human form. And he came to do it in a way that didn't pander to the existing systems of religion, but challenged the status quo in order to initiate something better. That something was the kingdom of God, the salvation of the whole world, and the renewing of creation. His voice, Jesus' voice, was truly prophetic in the proper sense of the word prophecy, to speak God into reality. I wonder, did the Pharisees prefer a pastoral leader more than a true prophet? One that would uphold its status quo in some sort of triumphal way? Remember, Jesus accuses Jerusalem of being the place where the prophets were murdered. In other words, the voice of prophecy had not gone down well through the centuries. And there is a tension between the pastoral and the prophetic in Christianity. Religious scholar Diana Butler Bass writes of this tension between the pastoral and the prophetic when it comes to upholding the institutional status quo. In her book, Christianity After Religion, The End of Church and the Birth of a New Spiritual Awakening, she writes this: religious faiths struggle between the pastoral and the prophetic, comfort and agitation. In a very real way, institutions are inherently pastoral. They reinforce the way things are, or were, through appeals to divine or supernatural order. They are always slow to change. Huh, that's true, isn't it? Institutions resist prophets. Prophets question. They push for things to be different. They push people to behave better towards one another. They want change. Gosh, don't we need prophets today? The history, she goes on to write this, the history of Christianity can be told as a story of the tension between order and prophecy. Jesus came as a prophet, one who challenged and transformed Judaism. A charismatic community grew up around his teachings and eventually formed into the church. The church organized and then became an institution. The institution provided guidance and meaning for many millions, and then it became guarded, protective of the power and wealth it garnered, the influence it wielded, and the salvation it alone provided. I agree with what she's saying, that Jesus came to challenge and transform, but that doesn't mean that Jesus came to start a new religion. In fact, I don't think he did. But a new religion developed and became the institution we now know as the church. And the picture that Bass paints can read as quite negative, but it isn't without hope. She goes on to talk about the rise of new prophets from within the institution. She writes this: many of the people in the church did not seem to notice this rise in institutionalism, but some did. What the church taught seemed at odds with their experience of life or God. They questioned the way things were done. They experimented with new ideas and spiritual practices. They bent the rules and often broke them. The established church typically ignored them, sometimes tolerated them, often branded them heretics, tried to control them, and occasionally killed them. When enough people joined the ranks of the discontented, the institutional church had to pay attention. In the process, and sometimes unintentionally, the church opened itself up for genuine change and renewal. And she goes on to pose a question in closing with these words: organized religion fears such outbursts, but spiritual outbursts almost always precede real reform. Might spiritual discontent be today's prophetic edge, needling institutions to listen, to change, to be more responsive and relevant? There's no doubt there was spiritual discontent when Jesus walked into Jerusalem, because we know that there were people there and then prepared to drop their nets and follow him. However falteringly, one minute marching boldly, the next minute turning to flee. But imperfect as they were attracted to something pure and good and noble. And likewise for us, there is an inherent goodness in Christ which we are wired to be attracted to. A hunger for justice, a yearning for peace, a desire to love, a blessedness coming in the name of the Lord. The prophetic Jesus voiced Yahweh's desire to gather her children to her, like a mother hen gathering her chicks under her wings. The question was, and might still be today for us, are we willing to be so gathered? And if we are, might we then be given the means to gather others? In his book, Piloting Church, Helping Your Congregation Take Flight, Cameron Trimble, asks the question, what is church really all about? Before going on to answer his own question with these words, I've always understood the church as being a community with a shared story in our scriptures, which binds us together. Church is about weaving relationships together so that life for all of us is more deeply rooted in love. Today, I would offer that the church also offers a platform to work together to build a world that acts and advocates for the common good of all of us. We are warriors, lovers, peacemakers, protectors, prophets, thinkers, and dreamers who gather together to celebrate our heritage as children of God. At the same time, we are fearlessly willing to stand up and stand in for those our culture might oppress. When we live consciously aware of our power to shape our world for good, we live lives of meaning. We are our own most fully human and fully sacred expressions. We are whole. We have an opportunity in this moment of our great transformation. We can approach this time as survivors, desperately clinging to our structures and ways of being. Or we can see ourselves as pioneers, setting out in the face of the unknown to discover new ways to live faith-filled lives. The inevitable decline of our structures gives us the chance to let go of what might hold us back from that adventure. Nothing today will be the same 10 years from now. Why not architect the kind of faith movement we want to see 20 to 50 years from now? What do we have to lose? Food for thought indeed. Let me close with the words of Psalm 27. Verse 13 to 14. I remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart. And wait for the Lord. Grace and peace be with you, everyone. Amen.
Let us pray. Loving Father, thank you that we have the name Children of God, sons and daughters of the King, brothers and sisters in Christ. Thank you that to each one of us you are a Father who provides, equips, strengthens, restores, heals, and holds us. We look in awe at the beauty of the creation around us, the spring buds, beautiful rainbows, geese flying across the skies, wildlife running or flying or swimming around us. We marvel at the miracle of birth and thank you for the blessings in death, where life in eternity begins. We also look with sadness, O Lord, at the hardship of poverty, famine, and war. Some have absolutely nothing and struggle day in and day out just to survive. Father, help us to serve the weak, walk with the weary, and help the poor. Help us to put into practice serving with willing hearts when our right hand doesn't know what the left is doing. We see the images on our TV screens of the Ukraine and cry to you for peace to rule over the land. We ask for a change in heart of the Russian leaders and advisors and seek your shalom, your protection, your mighty presence to be in the hearts and minds of the Ukrainian people. Help us to faithfully pray and show us how we can help those in the Ukraine or families here in Scotland so far from their loved ones. Father, we thank you for your church here on earth, not the building that we worship in, but the people who make the family of believers. We ask, Lord, that you would strengthen us, unite us in our fellowship and worship. Show us how to learn from and with each other. Help us to ask for help and trust one another to be open and honest when life is good or hard. We want to be encouragers of one another, who build each other up and quietly come alongside each other in times of need. And as human beings, we know each one of us will face these times. We lift to you all who are unwell, bereaved, lonely, and struggling. You, Father God, know us better than we know ourselves. You know our fellowship and neighbours better than we know them. And so we ask you would supply for all their needs, whatever they may be. We pray for Alistair and Sarah, Father, as they minister to us. We pray your blessing over the manse and ask it would be a home where there is quiet times for body, mind and spirit to be restored. Bless their marriage and their family. Guide them in all they do, in your name and for your glory. We bring ourselves before your throne of grace, Father, asking your blessing upon us. Help us to seek your kingdom in all we do. Help us to listen to you, as well as talk to you. Help us to carry the Christ light in our hearts as we go about our daily lives, allowing others to see your love within us. Make us your hands and feet, always ready to serve as Jesus served. We pray these things in his name. Amen.
This week with the Listening Cafe Monday 1 till 3, pop in and come along and get some support there. Tuesday the Guild meet at 2 o'clock in East Calder Church Hall, and next Sunday Songs of Praise on Zoom at 7 o'clock. The details are on the screen.
Since the Lord is my salvation, is there anyone to fear? As a citizen of heaven, why should I feel worry here? In a world that's lost and broken, and where sin and death abound, we rejoice for God has spoken. We are safe on solid ground. God will hide me in the shelter when the days of trouble come. Though a war may rise against me, God's own tent will be my home. I will trust what God has given. I will trust God's word to me. I'm a citizen of heaven, and it's what I'll always be. Even when I hear the warning, find a safer, easier way, I'll be faithful in the morning and at noon and close of day. As a citizen of heaven, I have nothing I should fear, for For in Christ I am forgiven, and am called to service here. You, O Lord, are my salvation, make me strong to live for you. May I care for your creation, love the stranger, speak what's true. May I share what you have given, may I seek each person's worth. As a citizen of heaven, make me useful here on earth.
We close our service with these words. God is our light and our salvation. We do not need to be afraid. God is a loving parent. We are well cared for. We follow Jesus into God's world. We go in hope. We go in love. The blessing of God is with you, now and always. Amen.
Upon